This is The Sim Pit. I'm your host, Sean Cole, but the real star of today's show is GT Omega with their new, robust GT Omega Prime chassis. And in the words of GT Omega, this new chassis is their best sim racing platform ever. And at $740, with its aluminum profile or T-slot or 80-20 design, it's completely adjustable, it's modular, it comes with a shifter mount. And with the Prime, officially, GT Omega has taken their first step into the enthusiast market of sim racing products. Now, if you're not familiar with GT Omega, they go back to 2009 and they've been known for some mid-level chassis for many, many years now. They are a consumer-focused company delivering a quality product at an affordable price. And at this point, with so many chassis, with so many revisions of chassis throughout the years, GT Omega have become one of the known name product brands in our industry. So this new GT Omega Prime, this thing is beefy. It is built on that super thick 140 millimeter by 60 millimeter or 5.5 by 2.36 inch aluminum extrusion and weighs in at a whopping 24 kilograms or 52 pounds. Now they say it's rated for 120 kilograms, which is like 246 pounds. And I gotta tell you, that must be a limitation of their seat. Cause I gotta tell you, I could park my car on top of a profile chassis just like this one. So as far as the strength, the only limitation's really gonna end up being the seat itself. It comes complete with a fully adjustable shifter mount, pedal deck, and wheel mounting system. Now we'll get more to the adjustability of those various decks, but the seat is a fixed location for the most part. But depending on the seat you install, it might have the ability to recline like mine does, or the ability to slide back and forth like mine does. And both of the seats available for the GT Prime from GT Omega also feature sliders and adjustable back. Now the version that I'll be testing is the GT Omega Prime without the seat. Now you'll also notice mine is in silver and black. This is actually a pre-production model and the final version are gonna come in a very sleek anodized black. So that's one thing you're gonna have to visualize different. And when you look at the website, you'll notice a slight difference between mine and theirs, including my custom Tenzo junkyard seat, which I do love and I've used for many, many DIYs, and I used it to complete this build as well. Focusing our attention on the wheel deck, despite its adjustability in distance, height, and angle, it is also pre-drilled for all of the common gear, including Fanatec, Thrustmaster, and Logitech, as well as my Sim Experience AccuForce wheel. This is also true of the pedal deck. It is also adjustable in various different ways, as well as compatible with all of the common gear from Fanatec, Thrustmaster, Logitech, and probably just about any other pedal on the market. And besides the adjustability, which we will cover later, the other nice thing about an extrusion or T-slot or profile, 80-20, whatever you want to call these type of rigs, is the customization. You can always continue to add extra pieces of 80-20 or various different brackets. As long as you have extra hardware, you can keep adding the things to this rig very easily and forever. Now, as I mentioned, the model I'm testing is the GT Omega Prime without the seat. Mine is in silver. You're gonna have to visualize it in that beautiful black anodized, and the purchase price is $740, including shipping here in the United States. You can also purchase the GT Omega Prime with the RS6 seat for $900, or with the RS9 seat for $920. The assembly of the GT Omega Prime is pretty straightforward. Now, my Prime came in two boxes, and I'm assuming that if you ordered yours with a seat, it would probably come in three boxes. Now, the smaller of the two boxes included a handful of customized plates by GT Omega, a wheel deck made of 1/4 inch thick aluminum, a shifter deck, a pedal tray, and a bunch of hardware, along with a bag full of finishing pieces. The larger or long box was filled up with the aluminum 80-20 profile extrusion tubing. After opening up all the boxes, after laying all the parts out and acquainting myself with them, comparing them to the directions, I learned there are a few things to really focus on. When it comes to the double wide profile, there are a few pieces to keep your mind on. The long side rails, they're the longest pieces. The uprights, there are two of these. They are the next longest pieces. And of course, the cross braces. So it all starts by attaching the long ones to the cross braces, and we use their hardware that is included to do this. Now, I do want to note one other thing. These little nuts, there are two ways to put them in. You can slide them into the end, but you have to move the little spring tab and pinch it and slide it in. Or you can insert them sideways and kind of flip them into the channel, even once things are boxed up. And that is really nice. On other designs that you can't slide them in, it actually means you have to take the whole thing apart to put hardware on later. In this case, though, you almost have to hear a click. You have to make sure it is smooth. You have to make sure it's in that channel properly, or it'll actually cross-thread the screws. So you almost want to hear a little click. That's when you know it. You got it right. So let's start with the two side rails. We're gonna add our hardware to the side rails per the instructions. We add two nuts per rail into the corner areas, and this allows us to attach the bracket with the bolt and screw it into the profile channel. Once we have both brackets onto one of these pieces, we can join them together by attaching the brackets to the other side. The next step is the forward cross brace for the seat. I looked ahead in the instructions and found the seat mount rails, the skinny ones, and I used them to measure the distance for the cross brace, and using two brackets per side, I installed it between the side rails at the seat bar distance from the back. I can then add the second long rail to the other side, matching the first side. Four brackets later, it's all starting to look like something. The next step is to add those seat mount rails. They sit on top of and connect to the back cross brace and the forward one we just installed. In a separate bag was a set of brackets, four of them. They are for this step in particular. These brackets have had the alignment tabs removed from the bracket on one side, and this allows it to sit at an angle not aligned with the slots. This side goes on the seat rails, with the normally tabbed side going down to the bottom rails and aligned normally. We don't have to tighten these down until we are adding the seat. Just get them in place and snug them down for now. So normally at this step, you would add the seat. However, I was building my rig up in the air on the table and I was a little concerned about weight and being able to put it back down on the ground. So I was gonna save that for later. However, with the seat in place, you'll be a better judge of where to install the wheel deck, which is the next step in the process. So to make sure things were close, I kind of got an idea where I'd want it to be. And you do need these two uprights to be nearly identical for the wheel deck to go between them nicely. So I used a measuring tape and I measured exactly where I was installing the first upright. And then also I could match that with the second upright. And the process goes like this. We used two of the medium sized double wide profile pieces and then these custom brackets. We used tapered bolts into the recessed holes to mount the bracket to the upright. And then we used four more of the tapered bolts to hold that bracket into the side rails of the chassis. We then repeat this for the other side and then move on to the wheel deck that goes between the two cross braces. It calls for four of those slide-in nuts being used in the front channel, two per side, and then using the larger or longer bolts to accommodate the thickness of the wheel deck. It has slotted grooves to be able to adjust the angle of the deck, and it will always be easiest to make those adjustments if the two uprights are the exact same spacing. The next phase of the build is the pedal tray, and my GT Omega Prime did have a little bit of damage in shipping on the pedal tray. It was where the slotted groove on the side is, and it was just a little bit dented out. So taking great care, I used a little bit of blue tape to protect the finish, and I put it on a piece of wood with a rag over it and gently hammered it back into place. No harm, no foul. The pedal tray mounts to the rig with two custom mounts that go on top of the front side rails. Two bolts later per mount, and we're ready for the tray itself. There are two regular bolts with regular nuts included in the hardware. These will hold the front edge of the tray into the mounts at a variety of heights or distances in these custom mounts. We can then attach the other side of the tray to the inside of the side rails with regular slip-in nuts and bolts. I have also left most of this semi-loose for later adjustment with my hardware. Next up is the shifter mount, and whether you're using a shifter or not, you're gonna wanna add this, so don't skip this step for sure because it actually adds structural integrity to the rig. It's part of the support system for the uprights, and the tray can always be used for a mouse or anything else you want handy while racing. The shifter mount is made up of a short piece of double wide profile along with the final single stick of the skinny stuff. We use two of the brackets along with two of the nuts to mount the two pieces together. It is then a custom bracket that goes at the bottom of that single stick with the tapered bolts and nuts, and then that attaches to the outside of the side rail in one of the four slots depending on the height you want. The double wide side then connects to the wheel deck upright with two more brackets. This could have been built for and installed on the left or right side of the rig. There's one more final custom plate for the shifter deck mount. It bolts to the double wide profile piece and can be adjusted in height, angle, and distance at this point. Once installed, we can bolt the shifter deck to that mount, and that step is now complete. Now it's time for me to put this rig down on the ground so I can add my seat, and it was at this moment that I realized just how beefy and heavy this rig is. It took all of my strength to actually lift it off the table and put it on the ground. I would suggest building it on the ground or getting help if you're lifting the rig. The seat bolts directly to the top two rails at the back. You will adjust their width based on the seat's dimensions, and then depending on your actual seat, it will either bolt right down or need some sort of adaption on your part. My seat rails are flat and the holes were large enough, so I just used the stock bolts and the slide-in nuts to take care of the rear end of the seat. On the front side, my mounts are actually at a different angle. I ended up installing two extra brackets that I had around and used a random bolt to hold the front mount of the seat to that bracket. It was a little rough around the edges and certainly not as nice as anything that GT Omega would have delivered, but it did get the job done. Now the final step in assembly really is the finishing touches. We're gonna add the feet to the bottom of the chassis, and they use the same slide-in bolts, and then the feet screw right into them. And then finally, the end caps. There's an end cap for every exposed end or edge of the profile tubes. They just sort of friction hold into place, and a good smack usually seats them nicely. And that completes the actual build process of the GT Omega Prime, which ended up being about 2 hours, including adapting my seat. And it was fairly easy, but we'll still have some fine tuning to do once we get all of our gear on it. But now we can take a good look, and we can see that for such a substantial rig, it does have a relatively small footprint. Overall, its length is 137 centimeters or 54 inches by 86 centimeters or nearly 34 inches wide, including the shifter plate. The width of the nose or the main structure is 58 centimeters or nearly 23 inches wide. The very top of the wheel deck support is 79 centimeters or 31 inches. And with my seat, it stood 109 centimeters or 43 inches above the ground. Other critical sizing that you may want to know is the opening for your knees or the footbox section. Between the upright columns, you have 60 centimeters or 23 and a half inches of width, which is exactly the same length of the wheel deck as well. The pedal tray measures in at 50 centimeters or about 19 and a half inches wide. And in length, it's 44 and a half centimeters or 17 and a half inches long with various different slots or channels running top to bottom. So before we install our gear, we can take a good look at the GT Omega Prime in its raw form. And it does look extremely sturdy. It does look extremely rigid. And I wouldn't exactly call it ugly, but I wouldn't call it elegant either. Now, when it comes to installation, one of the great features of the Prime is it's very compatible with all the common gear. So Logitech, Thrustmaster, Fanatic, check. It works with my Sim Experience AccuForce wheel and many other combinations as well. So starting with the wheel deck is pre-jeweled for everything, and two bolts later, my AccuForce is bolted down to the rig. The pedal tray is very large in size, and it has that series of slots going up and down. Depending on your pedals, and again, the GT Omega is designed to work with a large variety of pedals, you'll line your pedals up with the slots and then bolt them down. I had a few choices left to right that lined up with my Rickmotech, and four bolts later, they are bolted down as well. The shifter deck is also pre-drilled for common shifters, and in some cases, there's enough room for and holes drilled for both a shifter and a handbrake. I'm using the AIO log shifter and my giant Rickmotech handbrake. Despite the AIO logs not being a typical pattern, it bolted right to the plate, and my handbrake is easily adapted to any rig and also bolted down with two bolts in a matter of minutes. Piece of cake, other than the wiring. Wiring was a little tricky, as there were very few spots to anchor the wiring. So we did our best to tie them together and get them out of the way as best we could. So now we're starting to get there. We've got a fully built rig. We've got all of our equipment on the rig, wiring taken care of, and that takes us down to final adjustments. And this is an area that I feel like I need to be here kind of explaining it just the way it happens. Now, the beauty of a profile or T-slot or extrusion 80-20 tubing type rig is the infinite amount of adjustability. And by that, I mean, this wheel deck could go anywhere from all the way to the bottom to all the way to the top simply by loosening the bolts and sliding the apparatus. However, it doesn't always work that easy. When trying to move one bolt, it's real simple. But when trying to move this entire cross plate up or down, I need to loosen all four bolts and then try to move it, but they don't always cooperate. Sometimes you gotta kinda knock it, sometimes you gotta rock it, sometimes you gotta bust out the measuring tape to make sure they're equal. And that's the downside of making adjustments. So infinitely adjustable, but not always easy. If trying to move this entire wheel deck forward or backward, I'm gonna have to move all of these, the shifter apparatus and both sides all at the same time. That's four bolts here, four bolts there, two more down there, all moving in unison. It can be done, but sometimes it's tedious, sometimes it doesn't cooperate, but the end result is infinite adjustment. Now my seat comes with sliders, so when I'm making the final adjustments, I'm gonna put my seat all the way forward, set my wheel deck distance based on that, and then when I slide it back, it's easy to get in and out of the rig, and I can still use a keyboard on my lap if I'm doing something non-sim related. So that's how I decided where to set the distance for my wheel deck. When it came to the pedals, I started them off at the highest angle possible. And I found the angle too extreme for my pedals. I ended up lowering them to the bottom mount and then slid them towards me as well. As far as adjustment here, you pretty much have an unlimited front to back adjustment, an angle adjustment of just above flat to somewhere between 30 and 40 degrees of incline, depending on the lower mounting point. When it comes to the wheel deck, we again have nearly unlimited adjustment. As far as the deck height goes, like I said, it can slide all the way to the bottom of the rig or as tall as the uprights that allow about 25 inches above the pedal plate. In angle, there's really no end to the amount of adjustment to the deck. The distance of the wheel deck is also nearly unlimited in adjustment. However, it isn't the easiest operation. And then finally is the shifter plate. It is also fairly easily moved forward and back to about any location you could want along that side rail. Pretty much anything you need. You can then adjust the angle with the sliding channels, much like the wheel deck, to pretty much any realistic angle needed. The height adjustment gives you about 7 inches of total up and down, starting with the back mounting point. Mine is at the highest point on the side rail, but the lowest one is nearly 4 inches lower. And then the sliders on the shifter mount itself give you another 3 inches of up and down along with that angle adjustment. After the build, the installation of my parts, and the final tuning, this is what was very apparent to me about the GT Omega Prime. You virtually have unlimited adjustment. I can't think of a scenario where I wouldn't be able to get this wheel deck where I wanted at the angle I wanted. I can't think of a scenario where I'd have a set of pedals that I couldn't get at the angle and the distance that I wanted. And I can't think of a scenario where I wouldn't be able to get that shifter plate in the boundaries of everything realistic for a shifter or handbrake. It really is quite impressive. However, like I said, it might be tedious depending on how big of an adjustment it needs to be. How many of those slide-in nuts that you need to loosen, how many parts tied together do you have to move is the biggest part. But where there's a will, there's a way. You're gonna be able to get it just right. That is the main point here. So, as you know, building the rig is one of my favorite parts of this job. It's why I spend so much time focusing on the build itself. But for a lot of us, it comes down to driving. It really comes down to how does it perform out on track. The GT Omega Prime out on track, it's really hard to beat because the driving position of the chassis is like you designed it for yourself. You put every place exactly where you wanted it to be. It's not universal, one size fits all. This is an advantage over the conventional rig. Like a pair of pants or like fitting like a glove. Your wheel will feel smoother when its angle matches you. We're all different shapes, and we all might even be fighting our own ailments or past injuries to overcome while driving. Endless deck adjustment solves these issues in making driving easier and more precise. The operation of your pedals will also feel easier when the distance and angle is matched to the way your ass sits in the seat. Optimal distance for full throttle application without straining your ankles will make you more accurate and take less energy from you in the same action. The shifter spot was also right on the money and it allowed for easy grabbing without looking in a natural position. Now with both the shifter and the handbrake being on the same plate, it does limit the perfection between the two in height depending on the gear you're using. My handbrake is so large that it's hard to miss. So the ergonomic aspects of the GT Omega Prime is as good as it gets. It's as good as I've ever driven, and it's made for instantly being comfortable. This is also part to my seat, which is a great seat for sim racing and was bought off of eBay many years ago and has been used many times over. Your actual seat comfort may vary, but the ergonomics will be perfect if you take the time to dial it in. For my testing, I used some pretty heavy duty gear to really challenge the GT Omega Prime to see what it's made of. The wheel deck was being tested by my SimXperience AccuForce wheel with a 12-inch steering wheel for maximum amount of torque. And even at peak moments, there was nothing as far as a wiggle or movement from the wheel deck. No wiggle front to back, no wiggle left to right, and no twisting movement as well. This is one of the most solid wheel decks that I have ever tested. It is super duper sturdy and downright rigid. Admittedly, this is helped by that perfect ergonomics that allows me to put less friction on the wheel while dealing with even more torque. Moving on to the pedals, and they're gonna be fighting against quite a challenger, my Rikmotec GT Pro pedals with their monster hydraulic brake pedal. This is a match that is a real size up. And I gotta tell you, in this corner, you got the GT Omega Prime with the thinnest part of the whole rig is the pedal tray. You look at my pedals, you look at that tray, and you think, can the GT Omega Prime hold up? And when comparing it to the wheel deck, there is definitely a hint of flex when full pressure on my brake is applied. The movement is very minimal though, and despite being seen by the camera, it can be hardly noticed by my foot when driving. With the angle and the distance being so spot on, the flex was again less noticeable purely by the smooth operation of my pedals. So despite not being perfect, and an area that GT Omega could definitely improve their design, it is not to the point of an issue for the rig for me when driving. During my testing, I also used a medium strength shifter in the AIO logs. It is small and it is compact, but that detent has a good amount of pressure to it. When shifting, there's not a wiggle for from the shifter plate that I can feel. However, with that super duper heavy duty Rickmotech hydraulic handbrake mounted further out on the plate, there ends up being quite a bit of flex from that deck. Not only does it flex backward from the direct movement of the lever, but it also twists inwards towards the rig. It gets the job done, but for long term, I would likely design a brace of sorts to help out. We have definitely found the weakest part of the rig, but we did have to go to real extremes to find it. I'm sure that using the Thrustmaster handbrake would give slightly better results. And the other advantage of a rig that is this strong and rigid is the vibrations. For those who use butt kickers or transducers, you're gonna feel it even more through a rig like this. In my case, it was the beauty of my AccuForce wheel and its ability to have road vibration in the wheel. While on the GT Omega Prime, I could feel that kind of vibration from the wheel into my feet and into the seat as well. I have now spent many hours of racing the GT Omega Prime, and I have enjoyed every minute of it in comfort and a GT position ergonomics as if they had designed the chassis just for me. Well, I guess I built it just for me. I also have to add that getting in and out of the rig was very easy, and its left side opening is large and has clearance for my knees getting in and out. So that pretty much covers everything you need to know about the GT Omega Prime, from cost, delivery, how it's boxed, how it got here, building it, tuning it, installing our gear, getting it out on track. But just to make sure that we hit all of our marks, let's go ahead and break it down with the good, the not so good, and the bottom line, starting off with the good, and that being the GT Omega Prime is extremely strong and rigid. Bulletproof. Highly compatible, fits like a glove, nearly unlimited adjustment in the GT position. Finish on custom plates is very nice, smooth. Hardware can be installed after the build is complete. Wheel deck pre-drilled for most wheels, pedal plate pre-drilled for most pedals. Big pedal plate, no heel plate issues. Shifter mount on left or right side. Shifter mount pre-drilled for most shifters. Free shipping in North America. Can add extra profile in the future. Accessories. And now onto the not so good. The shifter deck flex doesn't even resemble the GT Omega compared to the rest of the rig. Very slight pedal plate flex. Slight damage in shipping, easily fixed. Would like extra brackets, extra nuts, and extra bolts for expansion. More adjustable feet for leveling. Tough to make adjustments. Top channel collects dust. No accessories. No custom wheel mounts, DD specific. And now on to my final thoughts. There are so many ways to judge a sim racing chassis. For those looking for simplicity, looking for elegance, then I gotta tell you, a bent tubing pre-built chassis is probably the way to go for you. But for those looking for the ultimate when it comes to rigidity, when looking for ultimate in strength, when looking for rigs ready for the new age, new era of direct drive wheels and heavy duty pedal sets, then an 80-20 rig, well, let's face it, it's probably the way to go. It's become very trendy, but there's a really good reason for it. They're as strong as it gets when it comes to sim racing. The GT Omega Prime fits well into that category and does offer something unique when compared to those other designs. But with free shipping in certain areas, it comes in quite a bit less money than the more refined and higher priced P1 chassis, for example. Now, when it comes to aesthetics, I gotta tell you, I love 80-20 rigs, but they're not the most beautiful. So when it comes to keeping the wife happy or something that needs to be in the family room and others are gonna see it, it might not pass the test. However, for a man cave or in the garage for us, the industrial look it has quite a place in our hearts. So for the hardcore sim racer, for those looking for sturdiness, for looking for rigidity, for looking for flexibility in terms of gear or adjustability, or the ability to expand for the future by adding hardware later, it's really hard to beat an 80-20 profile chassis, and the GT Omega Prime is a contender. So I hope you've enjoyed our review of the GT Omega Prime. I hope I've answered all the questions that you might have if you're considering one. And if you want to see more videos like this, be sure to subscribe to our channel. And if you want to watch me do my own personal racing, check out Sim Pit Live on YouTube as well. Thank you for watching. This is the Sim Pit. I'm Sean Cole, and I'll see you on the track.